Today, I am going to talk about delusions, and just to make sure everybody understands what I am going to talk about. A delusion is, roughly speaking, a pathological belief or abnormal belief which is held despite the obvious evidence to the contrary. And this belief can't be explained simply by reference to the social, cultural, or religious background. And delusion is usually associated with schizophrenia, but actually it can be seen in a wide variety of conditions other than schizophrenia, including dementia, Alzheimer's disease, and brain injury or stroke. So there are lots of conditions where you can see delusions. There are monothematic cases and polythematic cases of delusions. In the monothematic case, delusion is just about one particular topic or one particular issue. When it comes to this particular topic or particular issue, the person has delusional beliefs or delusional ideas. When it comes to any other topics, the person is perfectly fine. That's the monothematic case of delusion. In polythematic case of delusion, on the other hand, the person have delusional beliefs and ideas about lots of multiple topics and issues at the same time. Typically, the person has this kind of system of beliefs which involve different topics and issues at the same time. I'll give you some examples of delusions. The person with the persecutory delusion believes that he, for example, is harassed or harmed by other individuals or other groups at the school or workplace. Maybe somebody else in the workplace is kind of envious of you, and then the person is trying to prevent you from being promoted, for example. The person with so-called alien control delusion believes that his behavior is controlled by some external forces. Sometimes this delusion can not just be about the behavior, the bodily behavior, but also about the thoughts you have in your mind. So in that case, the person believes that the thoughts in the head are controlled by external forces. In that case, typically this kind of delusion is controlled. This kind of delusion is called the delusion of thought control. The people with capital delusion, for example, believes that his wife, somebody who is familiar to the individual, has been replaced by someone else, the imposter. So these are some examples of delusions, and obviously these delusions are very, very strange. We want to know why those people believe such things despite obvious evidence to the contrary. In other words, we want a theory of delusion formation. We want to know the process in which people come to form this kind of strange beliefs and maintain these beliefs despite obvious counter evidence. And there are many theories of delusion formation put forward by different groups of researchers. But I think it is fair to say that two of them are particularly strong and influential in the literature. One of them is two-factor theory of delusion formation, according to which delusions are, there are roughly two kinds of explanatory factors in the process of delusion formation. The other one is prediction error theory of delusion formation, according to which delusions are the product of some kind of disruptions in the processing of prediction errors. If you don't understand what I mean by this, don't worry, I'll be explaining in a minute. So those two theories, two-factor theory and prediction error theory, are very influential, and you might wonder which theory is right and which theory is wrong. And there is actually a debate about this. I'm inclined to think that before answering this question, the question about which one is right, which one is wrong, there is a conceptual and a theoretical issue that we have to tackle first, namely the issue of the compatibility between those two theories. If it turns out that those two theories are compatible with each other, then maybe we don't have to choose these theories, one of these theories. Maybe the both could be right at the same time. If, on the other hand, those two theories are actually incompatible with each other, then that means one of them, at least one of them, is false, so you have to reject at least one of them. And this question, the question of compatibility, is something that I am I'm discussing in my paper. And my view on this topic is that those two theories, although they appear to be incompatible with each other on the face of it, turn out to be actually compatible with each other. So at least logically compatible with each other. And then I also claim in this paper that those two theories are not just logically compatible with each other, logically consistent with each other, but also the basic ideas of those two theories can be combined with each other in a particular way to form a particular hybrid theory of delusion formation. And I will also argue that this hybrid theory has some nice, attractive features. Okay, so that's the main claims in this paper. So roughly speaking, the hybrid theory looks like this. The first factor of delusions, at least in many cases, is some sort of misleading prediction errors. The second factor of many delusions is the overestimation of the precision of the prediction errors at issue. I'm going to explain what this means in detail in a minute. The plan is very simple. First, I will explain some basic ideas of two-factor theory first, and some basic ideas of prediction error theory, and then I will explain my hybrid theory with some detail. Okay, first, two-factor theory. So basically, a two-factor theory says there are two explanatory factors in the process of delusion formation. The first factor is responsible for the content of delusion. It explains why the delusion has the particular content it has. Why, for example, the capillary delusion has this content, which is about kind of somebody, the familiar individual being replaced by imposter. The first factor explains that. Second factor, on the other hand, is responsible for the formation of the delusion. So it explains why the people, despite obvious counter-evidence, accept and maintains this strange idea in his or her system of belief. Two-factor theory is typically about monothematic delusions, so delusions about a particular topic, due to neurophysiological deficits like brain injury, like stroke. Typically, so I said typically, some people, some two-factor theorists have been trying to expand the theory a little bit, explaining other sorts of delusions, but I think typically this theory is about monothematic delusions due to neurophysiological deficits. Okay, so what is the first factor and the second factor of, say, the Kapler delusion? It is believed among two-factor theorists that, roughly speaking, the first factor of the Kapler delusion is some sort of abnormal experience of familiar faces. So, for example, if you have the Kapler delusion about your wife, you have some sort of abnormal experience when you look at the face of your wife. You might think of this experience as kind of recognition, familiarity without affective familiarity. So basic idea is that you can recognize the face as the face of someone you know a lot about. So you can recognize that. So there's a kind of, so you have this recognition familiarity with regard to the face, but nonetheless, you fail to have some sort of emotional or affective response to the face, which is usually associated with the recognition of the face with these features. So, kind of recognition familiarity without affective or emotional familiarity. And this hypothesis about the first factor of the Kapler delusion is actually consistent with the empirical evidence, which shows that people with Kapler delusion have abnormal autonomic activity in looking at familiar faces. So there's very strong empirical evidence for this hypothesis about the first factor. Okay, what about the second factor? So when it comes to the second factor, I don't think there is a shared view among two-factor theorists. The different researchers say different things, but my favorite view is that the second factor is what is known as the bias towards observational adequacy. It's, roughly speaking, it's the bias of putting too much emphasis on what you observe rather than the prior belief you already have. So, in general, when you form a belief or you revise your belief, there are, roughly speaking, two kind of things you want to care about. The first is prior beliefs. So you want to make sure that this hypothesis you are considering is plausible in light of the things you already believed, in light of the prior belief. But you also want to make sure that this hypothesis you are considering is consistent with the observational data you've got. Right, so you want to, you've got the data, you've got the observation, you want to make sure that your belief is consistent with that. So you have two things to care about in the in the process of belief formation and belief revision, prior beliefs and observation. And since the prior beliefs and observation are independent factors, they can go in different directions. You want to maintain the right kind of balance between those two things. If you like kind of Bayesian terminology, you might want to say roughly observation corresponds to likelihood, prior beliefs corresponds to prior probability, and you have to maintain the right kind of balance between prior probability and likelihood in calculating posterior probability. And basically, the Bayes rule says that you need to give them the equal weight in calculating posterior probability. Anyway, so you need to maintain the right kind of balance between prior beliefs and observation. And the idea here is that this balance, the right kind of balance, is somehow broken in the case of delusions, the capital delusion. In particular, the people have the bias of putting too much emphasis on the observation rather than prior beliefs. So what is going on in the case of capital delusion is something like this. You've got this observation, which comes from this strange experience, the recognition familiarity without affective familiarity. You've got the observation that this woman looks a little strange, or this woman feels a bit strange. So observation says there's something wrong with this woman or the experience of this woman. On the other hand, the prior beliefs say to you that this woman has to be your wife, because this woman looks exactly like your wife, and this woman who is in your apartment in this time of the day that behaves in this way, this woman should be your wife. So the prior beliefs says that this woman should be your wife. Because according to this hypothesis, the person with the capital delusion has the bias towards observational adequacy, putting too much emphasis on this one and neglecting or discounting this one, the person comes to the conclusion that this woman is not the real wife, that this woman maybe an imposter, or maybe robot, or Martian, or whatever. So that's the basic idea. So the bias toward this one rather than this one. So, but you might think, why is it that we need the second factor? Why can't we just say that the person has this abnormal experience and that directly causes this abnormal belief? Why do we need the second factor? There are some reasons, but I think the main reason is that it looks possible to have the kind of abnormal experience at issue without developing the capital delusion. And one famous example is the people with the damage in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. So there's evidence that the people with ventromedial prefrontal cortex damage share the same kind of abnormal experience in looking at familiar faces with the people with capital delusion. So the evidence is basically that the people with ventromedial prefrontal cortex damage and the people with capital delusion share that same kind of abnormal autonomic activity in looking at familiar faces. On the other hand, unlike people with Kaplan delusion, the people with the ventral medial prefrontal cortex damage do not seem to develop Kaplan delusion. So it looks like this is a case where people have this sort of abnormal experience at issue without developing the Kaplan delusion. But if that's the case, this shows that the first factor, the abnormal experience, is not sufficient for the development of the Kaplan delusion. So the story is like this. In the case of Kaplan delusion, the first factor, abnormal experience, and a second factor, the bias toward observational adequacy, and as a result, the people develop the Kaplan delusion. In the case of ventral medial prefrontal cortex damage, the people have the same kind of abnormal experience, but they do not have the bias towards observational adequacy. As a result, there's no Kaplan delusion. So that's the story. Okay, now I'm going to move on to prediction error theory. Roughly speaking, the idea is that the delusions are the product of the disruption of prediction error processing. And this theory is typically about delusions in the context of schizophrenia. And you might think of this as a sort of application of this predictive brain account or predictive coding account of the brain, according to which brain has this job of detecting prediction errors and then minimizing them. So according to this model, processing of prediction error is the fundamental job of the brain. And so the idea here is that the delusion is the product of some sort of problems or troubles in this fundamental job of the brain, namely processing of prediction errors. So I'll give you just a rough idea. In general, the prediction errors are surprising and remarkable and attention-grabbing, and they demand an explanation. So for example, if you look at this picture, you might think of it as a rabbit. It is a rabbit. And then you think that this is a rabbit, and not only that, consciously or unconsciously, you somehow bring in lots of expectations about the features of this creature and the behaviors of creatures. So you might expect that this creature is going to like to eat carrots, or maybe you might expect that this creature is going to jump like rabbits do. So you bring in lots of expectations here. It turns out that when this creature stands up, it looks like this. And there is a prediction error here because nobody, I thought, predicted these things, the long legs. And so there's a prediction error going on here, and these legs are surprising and remarkable and attention-grabbing, and they demand an explanation. We want to explain why. What is going on here? What kind of creature is this? It turns out that this is a special kind of rabbit living in the polar areas. They are called polar rabbits or polar hares. So they have some strange features to survive in the extreme condition they are in. Anyway, prediction errors are surprising, remarkable, attention-grabbing, and so on. So basic idea of the prediction error theory of delusion formation is that for some reasons, people with delusions have abnormal processing of prediction errors. In particular, you might think that the part of the brain which is responsible for the detection of prediction errors somehow misfires. So it is activated without actual prediction errors. This is actually one of the many possible stories you can tell. So there are different versions of prediction error theory. This is just one scenario. But the one scenario is that kind of brain is misfiring without actual prediction errors going on. And as a result, just ordinary objects and events around you appear to be really surprising to you and remarkable to you, attention-grabbing, and they demand an explanation. And delusions are, in the end, the explanations of these surprising objects and events. So, for example, you might find, so most of the people find just normal doors of the houses on the street, like these ones. nothing is really remarkable, just normal doors, nothing is interesting, nothing is really attention grabbing here. But the idea here is that somehow the prediction error detecting system or something like that is misfiring when the patient looks at these doors. As a result, the patient finds these doors to be surprising and remarkable and attention grabbing, and they want to somehow explain these doors. In particular, this pattern of color, the red green pattern. And maybe the patient comes to the conclusion that this red-green pattern is some sort of message from some unknown organization. So this is one possible way in which delusion of reference can be developed. Okay, now I am going to explain the hybrid theory, the combining those two theories together. You might wonder, first of all, whether those two theories, two-factor theory and prediction error theory, are compatible or not. And first, let us discuss the incompatibilism, according to which those theories are incompatible with each other. So I think there are some reasons for incompatibilism, some arguments for incompatibilism in the literature. But I think the main reason has something to do with the distinction between perceptual processes on one hand and inferential processes on the other. So roughly the idea is that the worry here is this. You might think that the two-factor theory is committed to a relatively sharp distinction between perceptual processes and inferential processes. So you might think that the first factor is roughly some sort of abnormal experience. And you might think that the second factor is roughly some sort of abnormal inference. So it looks as though two-factor theory is committed to a rather sharp distinction between what is experiential and what is inferential. Prediction error theory, on the other hand, tends to the prediction error theorist tend to be saying, tend to be denying the clear distinction between perceptual processes and inferential processes. So the reason is that, roughly speaking, the prediction error theory is, as I told you, is a kind of application of a more general theory of the function of the brain, according to which the brain's job, the main job, is to minimize prediction errors. It's the kind of Bayesian inferential mechanism whose job is to minimize prediction errors. It's a general theory of the function of the brain. And according to this view, even perceptual processes are inferential processes. They involve lots of inferential processes according to roughly Bayesian rules. Got prior probabilities and likelihoods and calculate posterior probabilities. That's definitely inferential process. The idea comes from the people like the Helmholtz. There's Thomas Bayes, the Bayes and Helmholtz. So this is the worry about the compatibility. So two-factor theory seems to be committed to the kind of rather sharp distinction between perceptual processes and inferential processes. Prediction error theory, on the other hand, seems to be denying the sharp distinction between those two kinds of processes. Then how can those theories be compatible with each other? So that's the argument. I think this worry is important and interesting. At the same time, though, I am inclined to think that this worry has been a bit exaggerated. And then I've got two reasons to think that it has been exaggerated. The first reason is that, strictly speaking, it is not the part of the definition of one first factor and second factor that the first factor is experiential thing, the second factor is inferential thing. I told you a few minutes ago, the distinction is rather about the content and formation. The first factor is whatever it is which is responsible for the content of delusion. The second factor is whatever it is which is responsible for the formation of the delusion. So that's the kind of official definition of the first factor and the second factor. So this is the quote from Coulthard and his colleagues. I quote, "The first of these factors is what initially prompts the delusional belief and is responsible for the content of the delusion. The second abnormality is what prevents the person from rejecting the belief in the light of the very strong evidence against it." They didn't use the term formation, so there are actually technical issues technical issues about the role, exact roles of the second factor, but basic idea is that the second factor is responsible for the formation. I think the second reason is a bit more important than the first reason. And the second reason has something to do with the levels of description. So in general, two-factor theorists are interested in the psychological level of description when they are talking about delusions. On the other hand, prediction error theorists, most of the time, are mainly interested in the neurophysiological level of description when they are talking about delusion. So when two-factor theorists seem to be committed to the sharp distinction between perceptual processes and the inferential processes, that is a commitment at the level of psychological, at the psychological level of description. And when, on the other hand, the prediction error theorists argue that there's no clear distinction between perceptual processes and experiential processes and inferential processes, that is typically a commitment at the level of neurophysiology. And the idea is that it is not obvious to me that these commitments in different levels of description are in fact incompatible with each other. It might turn out that experiential, inferential distinction is relatively sharp at the level of psychology. It might not be very sharp at the level of neurophysiology. So I've got the quote. The first one is from two-factor theory. And the second one is from prediction error theory. The first one says, as a two-factor theorist, my view is that the distinction between perception and belief is not easily dispensed with, particularly at the personal level of description. He means the personal psychological level of description. Second one, the boundaries between perception and belief at the physiological level are not so distinct. So they are talking about different levels of description. So maybe those two commitments are compatible with each other. I think this issue is somehow related to what Andy Clark calls the desert landscape scenario. in his paper, Whatever Next. So this is a scenario where something like goals, something like values, desires, and rewards do not really exist as such, because those kind of things, those kind of representations could be understood in the end as a sort of expectations or predictions. So there's no distinction between something like prediction or expectation and something like goals, something like values. So this is a kind of this is what he calls the desert landscape scenario. And then, interestingly, Clark argues that we do not have to accept this scenario, and he defends his view by appealing to the idea of levels of description. So he basically argues that this desert landscape scenario might be true at a level of description, maybe the fundamental level of description, maybe the neurophysiological level of description, but he also argues that it does not rule out the possibility of another level of description where we can talk about goals and values and desires and rewards. And he also says maybe it might turn out that this another level of description, where we can talk about goals and values, is the best or more useful level of description for some purposes. So I've got a quote from Clark. He says, even if such an austere description is indeed possible, so he's talking about desert landscape scenario, that would not immediately justify our claiming that it thereby constitute the better tool for understanding the rich organization of cognitive economy. To see this, we need only reflect that it's just atoms, molecules, laws of physics too, but that doesn't mean those provide the best construct and components for the systemic descriptions attempted by cognitive science. So he's basically talking about levels of description. Now, I think that this issue, the desert landscape issue, somehow corresponds to the issue I'm talking about the issue about the distinction between perceptual processes or experiential processes and inferential processes. And what I'm suggesting is that I can make a similar kind of move here. Okay, so what happens then if those two theories are compatible with each other? And I'm going to suggest that those two theories are not just logically compatible with each other, but they could be and maybe should be combined with each other in a particular way, and then I'm going to explain how exactly. So the idea presupposes the distinction, which might be familiar to some of you, might not be familiar to others, the distinction between prediction errors and their expected precision. Roughly speaking, the prediction errors are the mismatches between what is expected and what is actually observed. Precision or expected precision of a prediction error is, roughly speaking, the indication or indicator of the trustworthiness or reliability of the prediction errors. So when prediction errors are expected to be precise, the prediction errors are prioritized over prior beliefs, so the people put so much emphasis on them. When prediction errors are expected to be imprecise, on the other hand, the prior beliefs are prioritized over prediction errors instead. So basic idea is kind of, you might think of it as a kind of Bayesian process where first you've got prior beliefs, prior probabilities, and then also prediction errors, the likelihoods in Bayesian term. And when prediction errors are precise or expected to be precise, this one is going to be prioritized over this one. And when prediction errors are expected to be imprecise, this one is going to be prioritized over this one, prediction errors. So that's a very simple, a little bit Bayesian account of belief formation and revision. Okay, so on the basis of the distinction between prediction errors and their precision, I am going to suggest the following view of delusion formation. So idea is that the first factor of delusions, at least in many cases, I'm not going to say all cases for some reasons, at least many cases, the first factor is the misleading prediction errors. They are misleading in the sense that these prediction errors support some misguided or false representations of the world. Second factor of delusions, at least in many cases, it might not be all cases, is the overestimation of the precision of the prediction errors at issue. Let's go back to the two-factor proposal of the Capgras delusion. So this is the one I already talked about. So the first factor, abnormal experience of familiar faces. The second factor is the bias towards observational adequacy. So what I am going to do here, what I'm doing here, is to somehow reinterpret this proposal in the framework of prediction error theory. And then this is how it goes. First, the first factor, as I said, is the abnormal experience of familiar faces, the recognition familiarity without affective familiarity. And I think this could be understood as a sort of prediction error, a misleading prediction error. When you look at a familiar face, the face of your wife, since the recognition of the face of this kind has been associated with the right kind of affective response, now recognizing the face, the wife, you expect the right kind of affective or emotional responses. It turns out, however, that in the case of Capgras delusion, this kind of emotional or affective response is missing. So then this could be understood as the kind of prediction error. You expected some sort of emotional affective responses, however, you fail to feel these responses. There's a mismatch between what you expected and what you've actually got. So you can think of this abnormal experience as the kind of affective prediction error about familiar faces. And I would say this is a misleading prediction error because it supports somehow the misleading or misguided hypothesis about the identity of the particular individual. Okay? What about the second factor? So I said the second factor is the bias towards observational adequacy, the bias of putting too much emphasis on observation rather than prior beliefs. So my hypothesis here is that this bias towards observational adequacy could be understood as being driven by the overestimation of the precision of the affective prediction errors. So the person is experiencing this affective prediction errors. For some reasons, this affective prediction error is estimated to be or expected to be highly precise, and that drive the process of belief formation and belief revision. So the brain put strong emphasis on that rather than prior beliefs, which support the idea that the person is the real wife. So the picture here looks like this. First, you've got the observation, which is basically the effective prediction errors. Observation supports this idea that a woman is a bit strange, looks strange. The prior beliefs, on the other hand, support this idea that the woman should be my wife. For some reasons, these effective prediction errors are regarded to be highly precise. Its precision is overestimated. The brain has the bias of putting too much emphasis on this one rather than this one. And I think this is what is going on, underlying the bias towards observational adequacy. In other words, the bias toward towards observational adequacy is driven by the overestimation of the precision of the prediction errors at issue. So, roughly, that's my view. The first factor of the Kapwa delusion is the affective prediction errors about familiar faces. Second factor is the bias towards observational adequacy, which is driven by the overestimation of the precision of affective prediction errors. In the case of Kapwa delusion, first you've got affective prediction errors, and also you've got the overestimation. As a result, you have Kapwa delusion. In the case of the people with ventral medial prefrontal cortex damage, you've got the same kind of affective prediction error. You expected the affective response, which is actually missing, but this overestimation is not happening. As a result, you're not gonna have the Kapwa delusion. Okay, so there are two, I should have said two advantages. Two advantages of this view. One advantage is that two-factor theory is supported by a body of evidence. Prediction error theory is supported by another body of evidence. Well, hybrid theory is supported by both bodies of evidence, which is really good. Two-factor theory is, for example, supported by the evidence about the possibility of having abnormal experience without developing the Kapwa delusion. So some evidence about the people with ventral medial prefrontal cortex damage. Also, I'm inclined to think that the two-factor theory is, my version of two-factor theory is consistent with the findings about so-called jumping to conclusion bias, that the bias of coming to a particular conclusion on the basis of fewer evidence in comparison to normal people. That seems to be compatible with my hypothesis about observational adequacy bias. So they put so much emphasis on observation, new evidence. So they don't require much evidence before coming to the conclusion. On the other hand, prediction error theory is supported by, among others, an important study by the Colette, by Colette and colleagues, which is about the abnormal activity of right prefrontal cortex in response to prediction errors. So the normal people, the right prefrontal cortex is sensitive to the difference between the predictions that are true and the predictions that are false. So prediction errors and successful prediction. It turns out that the right prefrontal cortex of the people with delusions in the context of schizophrenia do not seem to be less sensitive to the distinction between successful predictions and unsuccessful predictions. So there's some evidence to believe that the processing of prediction error is abnormal in the cases of delusions. So that's the first kind of advantage. The second kind of advantage is that the hybrid theory seems to be able to explain a wide variety of delusions. As I said, two-factor theory is mainly about monothematic delusions due to neurophysiological deficits. Prediction error theory is, on the other hand, is typically about delusions in the context of schizophrenia. By putting those theories together, the resulting theory is able to explain both kinds of delusions, the monothematic delusions due to deficits, and the delusions in the context of schizophrenia. So the scope is really wide. So that's the second advantage. Okay, so to sum up, I proposed a particular hybrid theory of delusion formation, which combines the ideas of two theories of delusion formation. First factor is misleading prediction errors. The second factor is the overestimation of the precision. And in the case of Kaplan delusion, it looks like this: the affective prediction errors about familiar faces. And second factor is the observational adequacy bias, and that's driven by the overestimation of prediction errors. And then I talked about some advantages, about empirical evidence, and about the scope of the theory. There are some open questions, however. One question is about empirical testing. It looks all sounds nice, but can it be tested? How can we test it? What kind of test we can have for this hybrid theory? So there are some testing of two-factor theory, some testing of prediction error theory, but what's the testing? What's the test of the hybrid theory? So that's the open question. Another open question is this theory. I said this theory is applicable to at least many kinds of delusions, but I think it is an open question that whether this explains all kinds of delusions. On the face of it, there are some difficult kinds of delusions. In particular, the so-called anosognosia, that means denial of illness. So for example, you are not able to move your hand, it's paralyzed because of your stroke, and it is obvious to you that you can't move your hand, but you have the delusion that you can move your hand. It looks as though there's something slightly different going on in this kind of delusions. It's not that they have some sort of strange experience or prediction error first, and then somehow the prediction errors are kind of overestimated, and in that drive the belief revision. I think what is going on is kind of opposite. So you have some sort of prior belief that you are able to move your hand because that's what you have believed in your life for such a long time. And then the problem seems to be that the person, for some reasons, is not able to revise the belief you've already had in light of the new information, new experience, the experience of not being able to move your hand. So that kind of delusions seem to require a lot of different kind of story. I suggested in the paper version, we can just twist the story a little bit to accommodate this kind of delusions. The last open question, what are the clinical implications? Obviously, this is very urgent and important issues. So it is very nice if this story is good, but what does that tell us about, for example, the effective means of intervention into delusions? I'm inclined to think that two-factor theory tends to be associated with something like cognitive behavioral therapy. Prediction error theory has been associated with some intervention on the basis of drugs. I think the hybrid theory is going to support kind of hybrid intervention involving something like cognitive behavioral therapy and something like drugs. But I'm very happy to talk about that kind of thing in the Q&A. Thanks. That's it.